The back of the Atlas Center is an area they call the graveyard. Here is the final resting place of structures that weren't tough enough to stand the test of time. Working with metals has always been dangerous. Back at the smelting furnace, there is a Shinto shrine devoted to a sacred deity the workers believe helps keep them safe. These elaborate rituals are not just about safety, but as Mike Notice explains, also quality control.
In modern industry today, we depend very strongly on quality control. The ancient Japanese swordsmith used religious ritual as their process control to make sure that each and every time that they manufactured this same object, it was done exactly the same way. They didn't have science to do it, they had religious ritual.
If you think that what you are doing has religious significance, you pay extra attention to it.
Ken Craft, a professor of religion and an expert on medieval Japan, says this reverence helps explain why the sword is so important in Japanese culture.
They say that the sword is the soul of the samurai. In almost all pre-modern cultures, matter and spirit were interfused. And so it wasn't so hard for them to imagine that an object could have this kind of power, what's called a numinous power or an otherworldly power. And in Japan, the gods could be found in any natural object, including waterfalls or trees or a mountain. So it wasn't a big leap for them to think that an object as powerful and as beautifully made and as reverently made as a sword could have some sacredness to it.
It is that sense of the sacred that drives Master Kehara. After 36 hours of feeding the voracious fire, everyone is exhausted. But Kehara carries on, never sleeping, always keeping vigil. In ancient Japan, sword makers and the weapons they helped to produce were vital to the noblemen and the samurai. They were the military-industrial complex of their day, which helps explain why their metal techniques became so advanced.
Around the whole world at 1700, the Japanese were the masters of this particular technology that produced swords. So we have to remember, we're dealing with a culture in which the military dominated for 400 or 500 years. That gave them a lot of time to perfect whatever military implements they wanted.
Using only the ancient methods, Kehara monitors the process by watching and listening to the fire. On the morning of the fourth day, Kehara can tell by looking and listening inside the core of the tatara that it is time to break up the furnace and extract the steel ore.
I could see the core. It looks good. There's a big relief. I'm happy.
Happy, yes, but no one can afford to relax yet. Until they get the steel out, there's no way of knowing if it's samurai sword grade or only good enough for kitchen knives. Once the ingot is cooled, it will be broken into small pieces. This process helps to sort the steel. Pieces that break off easily are more brittle. Parts that are more difficult to break apart are tougher. The most skilled masters are those that can deliver the best quality of both types.
It's like when your child is born. It was worth waiting for. I'm very happy.
Kihara will then choose which of these pieces is good enough to go to the sword maker, who will give this raw steel its famous shape. While craftsmen like these keep the tradition of sword making alive, the legend of the samurai also lives on in the popular imagination. The samurai are to the Japanese culture what cowboys are to America, heroes of a lost era. Surprisingly, samurai movies had a big impact on the American Western itself. Akira Kurosawa's famous film, Seven Samurai, was turned into the classic Western, The Magnificent Seven. The stories are nearly identical. Seven brave warriors rescue a poor village from bandits. The heroes are reluctant to use their weapons, but expert at it. Both of the leading men are bald, Takashi Shimura and, famously, Yul Brynner. There is one big difference. In the American version, the sword was replaced by the classic six-shooter. Both, however, do the trick.
Man with no name. Danger fits him like a tight black glove.
Another Japanese classic, Yojimbo, became Fistful of Dollars, which launched Clint Eastwood's movie career.
I don't think it's nice you laughing.
Even Tom Cruise tried his hand as the improbable Last Samurai. All of these movies show that sword fighting, like the gun battles in westerns, makes for good cinematic action. One samurai film buff calls it sword porn. To create the perfect fighting sword, or prop, form and function were engineered together. The laws of physics dictate the sword's unique curved shape.
With the curve of the blade, if you're doing a slashing motion, it actually makes it possible to move the blade in an arc, which is what you want to do when you slash something. If you have a straight blade and you attempt to slash, at some point you have to slash and then pull because the blade is straight.
To create its unique shape, the raw steel must be forged into the fighting blade. And while the work of a blacksmith seems pretty straightforward, brute strength that muscles metal into shape, the real secret is what is going on deep inside the metal. Sakurai is a small town not far from the fabled city of Kyoto, and home to Gasan Sadatoshi, one of Japan's most renowned swordsmiths. His family has been in the business for generations. The pieces of raw steel arrive from the smelters. Together with his son and assistant, Gasan carefully examines the tamahagane to see if it is up to scratch for his next sword. Gasan can judge from the texture and color of the raw steel just how much carbon is in it. Brighter pieces have more carbon.
The great swordsmiths of Japan were far more than just blacksmiths. They weren't just people who bashed metal into a sword shape. They were more like alchemists.
Historian Stephen Turnbull from the University of Leeds is a renowned expert on the samurai sword.
They were steeped in the mysterious traditions of the metal, how it was melted, how it was molded, how it was beaten. They may not have understood the chemical composition of it, but from years of practice, years of apprenticeship and years of tradition passed on from master to pupil, they were able to transform this mystery into something that was very, very real, the samurai sword.
Remember how at the smelter's furnace, some of the metal was of a different atomic composition that made it either harder or tougher. Gassan needs to find the best quality pieces of both types because part of his art is to find a way to combine them so that the sword will have the advantages of their different characteristics. There is really still only one way to learn the art of sword making. Through apprenticeship. No easy career path. They rise at dawn, help with household chores, and work with their master 6 days a week. It takes years to learn correct forging technique. The untreated metal is protected from rusting before the process begins. Heating softens the steel for hammering so that the pieces can be formed into one. The hammering also drives out most of the remaining impurities called slag. Molten slag can be seen in some of the dramatic sparks as it is squeezed out of the steel by the hammering. The steel is pounded flat and then folded time and time again to thoroughly mix the iron and carbon. Gassan gauges the concentration of the carbon by the way the steel bends. How good a job did the ancient blacksmiths do? With modern tools, we can see. Using a special electron microscope, trace amounts of unwanted elements like sulfur or phosphorus that would weaken the steel can be detected.
And what you see on the right side is the X-ray spectra collected from that area, which shows only the presence of iron, which is the high peak, and carbon all the way over to the left, which is the low peak. We can tell this is a very high quality steel. It's got only iron and carbon present in it.
Another thing that is happening in this brutal pounding of the steel is that the shape of the metal, all the way down to the atomic level, is changing.
The material is actually getting harder as it's hammered. And many people have the experience of bending something and feeling it get harder. And a great example is if you're trying to run copper tubing, installing an ice maker, doing something like that. Initially, when you get the tube in a coil like this, it's relatively easy to change its shape. You can straighten it, make it go around corners, whatever you'd like to do. But if I make a mistake and try to change the shape of it at this point, once it's already been straightened, it gets much more difficult the second time, and even more difficult the third time to straighten it out again. Because every time I bend it, I create lots of microscopic defects inside. And the more defects I have, the stronger the material gets. Now, the smith ultimately would like to keep changing the shape of the sword, and so this hardening is not really what he wants. So he can put that sword back in the flame, heat it up, and the heat will heal the defects. At that point, the material will go back to being relatively soft and formable, and the cycle can be repeated over and over again.
These defects also play a key role in giving metals one of their unique characteristics, their bendability. As Vinci explains, this bending happens at the atomic level.
Metals have this capability in which when you apply a stress, the atoms can move and they can swap locations within their general arrangement. And they don't mind being in this position or this position or this position. And for that matter, when they move from one position to another,